يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة. I just have to comment and say that those two recitations were some of the best recitations I've heard, especially the youth lecture. So please give them a salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa anjil rajam. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa salatu wa salamu ala afdal al-anbiya'i wal mursaleen, ba'di al-khalaqi ajma'in. سيدنا وسندنا وشفيعنا مولانا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى لبيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين الذين اصطفاهم الله أجمعين أما بعد فقال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأقيم الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسر الميزان صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. My respected brothers and sisters, I bid you all السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I start in the name of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the Omniscient, the Omnipotent. All grace is due to Allah, for He has blessed us with this existence. And we know from the discussions which we've had is that at one point you and I were not existent, and Allah has brought us into existence. And the most beautiful thing about our existence is it's not haphazard, and it's not motivated by any vengeance or hate. And we were not simply created in any state, rather our existence is the best of existence. As we know, Allah states in the Quran, فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنَ الْخَالِقِينَ. Allah has the best of creators. And you and I were not simply created by an accident, but we were planned and purposely created in the most creative of manners, hence the complexity of our existence. And the beautiful thing is that as much as you look around you, you'll find the diversity in our existence. Allah could have created us similar, everyone in a similar fashion. But imagine how mundane our existence would be. And imagine how boring our existence would be if everyone looked the same, if everyone moved the same, if everyone spoke the same, everyone had the same thoughts. Our existence, my existence, and your existence would not have the same value that it has now. Interestingly, you'll find that even identical twins have different fingerprints. Allah is showing us that human beings have been created differently in many areas, not only physically, but also demographically. You'll find that some are rich, some are poor, some are tall, some are short. Some have the best of health, some not the best of health. And when we examine the justice of Allah Azza wa Jalla and we ask, why is it that Allah has created our system in this way? It comes back to point that no individual in our existence has all of the perfect qualities. You can never find the perfect human being. Hence any individual, any male who's looking for the perfect girl, she doesn't exist. Or any girl who looks for the perfect male, he doesn't exist. There is no perfect individual. And it's interesting that you and I share different qualities within our existence. I might be an individual who's poor. Next to me is an individual who's rich. He might possess material wealth. I might possess wealth and values. As a poor human, I might have values of patience, while the individual who's materialistically rich might not have that value. I, in my opinion, I see that this individual who's got these values can be left at a higher level than this individual who's got only materialistic value. And the point of our existence at the end of the day is that you and I transact completely with our actions and our motives. Ever ask the question, why is it that within our existence today, and it's interesting to me, there are about 7 billion people. Let's look at the demographics and say that let's say 2 billion of them are Muslim. An even smaller amount, maybe 500,000 may be Shia, and an even smaller amount, maybe 200,000 may be ones who are practicing. Does that mean that Allah Azza wa Jal, the All-Merciful, who's created all of these individuals, is gonna banish 6 billion to hell and leave maybe 1 billion who are going to heaven? Because sometimes we think that I've been given this gift of Islam and somebody else hasn't been given this gift.
Does that mean that my existence is better than theirs, or that I am at a higher level? Nonetheless, Allah is saying that I've created some of you with gifts. Some of you have been given with, have been born with different gifts. It's your opportunity to share with your existence. Because as we stated, to be stingy as a human being with your religion is one of the worst assets that a human being can have. And hence the purpose here of why we are so different, why our existence is different, why demographically we're different, why physically, materialistically we're different. Allah is saying it's simple. You who has what I've given him, who's been given the gift, needs to move and share with the ones who haven't been given the gift. And at the end of the day, the system balances itself out. Hence Allah in the Quran says, وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْقِسْطِ وَلَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ. Keep balance to the scale which I've put on the earth, and do not flip the balance of the system. And I would argue, as one might say, that, oh Allah, why haven't you made me materialistically rich? Or, oh Allah, why have you not given me the best levels of beauty? The argument here is that these can actually be a pain in your life and not of value. These could actually be pain and not a value. Examine an individual who might be extremely wealthy. True that he's very well off and he's able to bring many things on the table and he has a lot of things to offer. But imagine the relationship with this individual who's rich has with others. The minute you have the wealth, you can't easily choose a spouse out there. Because how do you know this individual is not after your money and is after your character? How do you know that tomorrow when you die, your kids won't tear each other apart with the wealth? How do I know that this wealth won't bring me friends who are simply interested in my wealth and nothing else? Allah is saying, as much as it's a positive, beware, because there's a negative. Beauty is the same thing. Today, something that's very much sought after is beauty. Interestingly, when we examine the story of Yusuf within the Quran, beauty within itself is very detrimental, that the minute he is extremely beautiful, everyone is chasing him, and he says, O Allah, as-sijnu ahabbu ilayya min kaydihin. O Allah, prison to me is much more interesting and is much more intriguing than them chasing after me. And we don't realize that with beauty come burdens, because now people are chasing you, trying to tempt you, trying to bring you into different relationships. And we don't realize that the more beautiful I become as a human being, the more the world opens its arms to me. Now I've got tens and thousands of traps to fall in. Allah says, the position I've given you is the perfect position. Hence, as much as beauty is a blessing, it can at one point be the biggest test. As much as wealth is a blessing, it can be the biggest test. Knowing that Allah Azza wa Jalla has created us to transact, you'll find that even the beginning of our existence, the dialogue which happens between Allah Azza wa Jalla and the angels is quite intriguing. It's on this level of interaction. When Allah first creates Adam and he says to the angels to bow down to Adam, the reply of the angels is interesting. They say, O Allah, should we bow down to an individual who might cause harm and bloodshed within this world? And interestingly, even Shaytan is at this level arguing with Allah Azza wa Jalla. Look at the importance of dialogue and interacting. Allah, the all-knowledgeable, could have looked at the angels and said, look, you have no understanding of why I've created Adam. Allah, the all-knowing, forget somebody arguing with you and me. Someone is arguing with Allah, the all-knowledgeable. And it's interesting that if the creator of the heavens and the earths can peacefully have dialogue with angels and shaitan who are going against his command, then imagine the level of dialogue and tolerance that you and I should have. How much discussion should you and I have? How much interaction should you and I have? And interestingly, within the Quran, Allah does not banish them to hell. Allah doesn't look at the angels and say, you know what, I've created you and I'm so sick of you replying to me, I'm just going to banish all of you to hell. So please take a corner and take another left and that's where you find your area. No. Allah has dialogue. Allah is now communicating with the angels that this is my level of communication. إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. I know what you do not know. And Allah is now opening the terms of dialogue. Interestingly, within the Quran, dialogue has a very high level. And even the school of Ahlul Bayt, which you and I pride ourselves in, was built on the basis of open-mindedness. People who are extremely open-minded. A man, for example, comes to Imam al-Sadiq. He says to him, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, I've got one thing to tell you. I think I'm a creator just like your God. Imam says to him, explain. He says, well, you know, when I was walking, I saw a pile of soil. I took it up. I shook it. Worms emerged. I think I created from soil worms. This is a man who's speaking to the Imam. Imam says to him, no problem. Take me to the area where you were standing. And you and I can discuss this because there has to be some sort of dialogue. Imagine normally this happens to you and I, and somebody comes and says, I'm a creator. Like, what are you talking about? Where did you come from? Please, I don't want to argue with you. I don't want to discuss with you. But look at the level of open-mindedness of an imam. That somebody comes to him and imagine the level of knowledge an imam has. Not a normal human being, but the knowledge that the imam possesses. He could say that I've got all the knowledge. This guy is just speaking nonsense. Imam says, no, let's go to the area where you saw the soil. And I want to discuss this with you. I want to have dialogue with you about this issue. He takes the imam, he takes another some soil and he shakes it, worms emerge. He says to the imam, you see, I've got worms right here, I created them. Imam says, put them on the ground, he puts them on the ground. He says, as their creator, I've got a question for you. Can you tell me which one of these is male and which one of these is female? He says, you know what, I have no idea, sorry, I couldn't help you. Imam looks at him, he says to him, no problem. I've got one more question for you. Can you tell me, as their creator, which one of these, what's their weight? What's the weight of each of these worms? Which one weighs how much and this one weighs how much? He says, you know what, I can't. Imam says, no problem. One last question. As their creator, since you created them and they are dependent on you because whatever you create is dependent on your existence, can you tell them if they are going to the right, tell them to go to the left? Simple, because you're their creator, you should be able to tell them what to do. He looks at the imam, he says, I can't. Imam says, what kind of creator are you? You don't know how much your creation weighs. You don't know which one is male and female, and you can't even tell them to go from one direction to the other. That imam opens the lines of dialogue. He is discussing with them. I am willing to have a discussion. And it's sad that today within our communities, a person comes, a young child comes, and looks at you and says, I have a problem with the existence of God. I don't believe God exists. Good luck if you see this person once again in the masjid. He's banished in certain instances, I swear to you. That if a child wants to come forward and ask, I have a problem with this, or I've got a problem with this, prove this to me, prove that to me. Alhamdulillah, certain communities are extremely open-minded, but many will banish the individual. It's impossible for you to be here again because you've questioned God's existence. Not until we question these things do we truly understand what it's about. And I understand sometimes certain parents will get worried, you know, my son is questioning God's belief and he's questioning imam and he's questioning these things. I'm really worried. It should worry an individual. And if I was a parent, I'd be terrified. But also the positive is that your child now will gain more sincerity and certainty. Because Abu Ahmed al-Ghazali comes forward and he beautifully states that the more skeptical an individual becomes in his life, the more certainty he has when he's on his deathbed. The more certainty you and I have, The more skeptical we are, the more certainty we have on our deathbed. Now this dialogue, keeping this in mind and understanding that you and I need to have open lanes of dialogue, Allah comes beautifully within the Quran and states, have dialogue with every individual. And Allah speaks about having dialogue with Christians, Ahlul Kitab, Christians and Jews. Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ ألا نعبد إلا الله ولا نشرك به شيئا ولا يتخذ بعضنا بعضا أربابا من دون الله فإن تولوا فقل اشهدوا بأننا مسلمون. Allah is saying, all you who believe, have dialogue with Ahlul Kitab. Speak to them. Invite them. Bring them forward. Discuss with them. Have unity with them. That we will only worship one God. And we will not give any partners with Allah. فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا, if they walk away from you, move back and say, I submit to Allah and you have your religion and I have mine. Allah is clearly indicating, have dialogue with these individuals. On this basis, I'd like to dissect something today of contemporary thought. English ethologist and evolutionary biologist, Dr. Richard Dawkins, came out with an interesting statement recently at a military expo. And in front of a big crowd, he stated, this is a very well-known statement which he recently made. It's quite interesting that it's coming from a man with the stature of an atheist. As you know, Dr. Richard Dawkins is the author of the book called The God Delusion, which is a book which is, if you read it, it's a very clear, full-throttle attack on any theistic belief. And he comes forward and he states, in a recent military expo, he says that all religions within Europe are dying. And I'm quoting his words, except for the religion of Islam. And interestingly, for these words to come from a man who is hating God and to admit that all religions are dying except for the religion of Islam, to you and I, that's a great piece of movement, that it's coming from the mouth of an atheist. Interesting. Now, let's take a look at this and dissect and understand what are three different factors today which have kept the religion of Islam moving. Because when you examine the Holy Quran, interestingly, Allah states, with regards to the Holy Prophet, he makes a prophecy. He says, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. We have elevated your status. You know what's interesting about this? Is that when you go to the UK today, for 5 consecutive years, the most famous name given to newborns in the UK is Muhammad. Aflahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. It's as if the prophecy is becoming very clear and Allah is clarifying that as I stated, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ will eventually one day happen. And it's happening. And even though the bombardment on the attack of the religion of Islam, you'll find that cartoons are coming out and movies are coming out and different accusations and wars here and there. Interestingly, the religion of Islam has been able to come out as the largest growing religion in the world. And for a statement to come from an atheist that Islam is the only religion in Europe which is not dying is very interesting. Now you might think, why is it important to dissect such a topic? Why is it important to discuss this? As we stated 2 nights ago, the minute you and I accept an atheistic movement, then the value of my life and your life deteriorates and we become simply carbon-based, purposeless computers. That's the main problem. That's when I don't have a belief, when I don't believe in an area where I came from, and I don't believe that I'm going somewhere, I simply become a walking, talking computer. There's no purpose which drives me. There's no reason for me to get up in the morning. There simply is, I am here, and I'm not going anywhere. It's as if I'm walking down a black tunnel and I'm walking step by step. If I fall, no problem. If I survive, no problem. Same thing. It's important to dissect this for this main reason. There are three main reasons that the religion of course, the main reason is that Allah Azza wa Jal has kept the religion safe. But there are three main logistical reasons which I've seen, which have really opened my eyes, that the religion of Islam has kept safe and has not been tampered with or changed and has kept its momentum. The first reason is that the religion of Islam prides itself in being a religion of balance. Religion of balance. Everything that a Muslim does within his life has to be to a practical application of balance. As much as theoretical religion is great, the best form of religion, in my opinion, is something practical. Where you and I walk out of the majlis, when we walk out of the mosque and we say, I have today learned something practically. There was a practical application. I know how to practically apply something in my life. Theoretical things are great. History is amazing. But to have the practical application of the religion is extremely important. And hence Islam comes to balance the life of an individual practically. It doesn't tip the scale to one extreme or the other. It's practical and upright in the middle route. Here's an example. One day the Messenger of Allah is walking in the masjid and he sees a man constantly praying. He walks in, he's praying, he walks out, he's praying. 2 hours later he's praying, 10 hours later he's praying, constantly praying, 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 praying. The Messenger of Allah comes to him and he stands next to him. He says, Habibi, I have a question for you. I see you praying all the time, which is great. Can you tell me who's taking care of your family? Who's at home with your family? He says, Ya Rasulullah, I love to pray. Prayer is my delight. At home, my brother's taking care of my family. Don't worry about it. It's okay. The Messenger of Allah looks at him. He says to him, your brother is better than you. Your brother is greater than you, for he is practically taking care of your family, and you have left your family for this extent. Salah is important, sayah is important, motivating each other is important. At the end of the day, monkery in the religion of Islam is not accepted. Some people think that I can sit at home and pray 24/7 and seclude myself from society. I don't have to be within my society. No, within the religion of Islam, something like monkery is not allowed. And Islam comes forward to remove any sort of extremism. Any sort of extremism within our lives is to be removed. Hence, one balance that the religion of Islam stands out from any other religion is the balance between spirituality and reason. Spirituality and reason within the religion of Islam are two things which are given a balance. Here's an example. You'll find that, for example, within the religion of Hinduism, Hinduism prides itself in the spiritual factor and the spiritual stories to such an extent that today when you go to India, you'll find monks or certain gurus by the name of Sai Babas. And here's what these guys do. They go rolling from town to town in a spiritual act. Meaning they'll go from southern India and they'll roll the whole way to the northern part of India, and they'll have bruises and cuts all over their bodies by the time they get to the north. And other feats of spirituality, what some will do is they'll stand, one of them stood for 5 years. Stood, standing, never sat for 5 years. It's a spiritual act in order for you to get closer to the religion of Islam. To the religion of Hinduism, you'll come to the individual and ask him, what is the practical application? Forget spirituality. What's the basis of reason? It's not there. The same individual, you come to ask him, is God infinite? He'll say to you, God definitely is infinite. How many gods do you have? Well, we have more than one God. We have one God, which is our main God, but God has many reincarnates. Specifically in the religion of Christianity, you'll come to any Christian, you'll say, how many gods are there? They'll tell you one. But God has a son, God has a spirit, there's a father. We split him into three. And interestingly, the question that we ask is, if God is infinite, here's the link between spirituality and reason. We believe in Allah. We pray to him. We are motivated to him 24/7. But the minute we pray to a God who reasonably we have not been able to conceive, our salah becomes simply a spiritual act and no longer an act of reason. You'll come to a Christian, you'll ask him, I've got one question for you. If God is infinite, can you divide him by three? Mathematically, can you and I ever take God and divide him by three? Impossible. Specifically, mathematically, infinity can never be divided by three. Hence, any individual today who takes God and is able to divide him into three, into different reincarnates, has not understood that God within himself is infinite. He cannot be perceived, he cannot be seen. Today, even within sects of the religion of Islam, some might say that God has a hand, God has a throne, God has a face, God has a leg. Interestingly, God is infinite. You cannot even come to fathom Allah Azza wa Jal. Any individual who comes towards this path and states that God has a physical body has not understood that God is not infinite. And if God becomes finite, then a finite being must have been created by something else. Because anything which is finite has to be linked to something which is infinite. If Allah Azza wa Jal is infinite, then that individual no longer becomes God. He is now has to approach infinity. Hence our existence, my existence and yours, as finite individuals, we are linked completely to Allah Azza wa Jal. Anybody who comes forward and says that Allah has a son, the question that we ask is, how can Allah conceive when he is infinite? You don't know if he's male, if he's female, if he's any of the above. That's one concept. The second concept that Islam comes to bring balance in is with regards to science and understanding of faith. We don't simply believe everything on a faith-to-faith basis. Rather, 50% is faith and 50% is science. And as Albert Einstein famously said, science without faith is blind. Faith without science is foolish. Because they help each other on a 50-50% basis. The third concept which has kept the religion of Islam safe today and has not allowed it to be changed is the concept of infallibility, which we spoke about yesterday. When the religion has a protector to care for it, when the religion has someone to safeguard it from being changed in one area or another, you will most likely have no change within the religion. And please, brothers and sisters, I invite you to study this. Examine any religion in the world. You'll find no religion today has infallible leaders who've kept their religion safe. Everybody has mixed the good and the evil. One leader is good, the next one is evil. And we're constantly moving on the basis of, let's pick our leaders. If he's good, great. Society will follow him. If he's bad, we'll try to get rid of him. And it's interesting today that you have a president like Bush who leaves office with a 67% hatred. It's as if Allah is telling me, O mankind, have you not learned what a bad leader is? Do you not know how to pick your leaders anymore? Don't you know how to pick a good leader and a bad leader? And Allah is showing us that only through infallibility can your religion never be tampered with. And I take pride in a religion which is ultra, ultra, ultra monotheistic. Islam hinges on the concept of tawheed and monotheism. And I invited specifically my young brothers to do research with regards to the monotheism of the religion of Islam. Examine tawheed, strengthen it. I swear to you, the religion is tied as a neutral, the nucleus of the religion is tawheed. And the minute we understand it, then we branch out to everything else. Allah is saying that only through infallible individuals can your religion be saved. The final point as to why the religion of Islam has been saved today and has been given so much publicity is because the enemies of Islam don't realize that any media outsource which is being sent against the religion is actually doing the marketing for the Muslims. You and I don't have to do much marketing for the religion of Islam. When an individual hears something like September 11 happens, or a bombing happens, or they see a sister wearing hijab which represents Islam, or they see something else, immediately the individual starts to research the religion. As much as something like September 11 is an extreme negative, and we bring down any person who's committed such a hate crime, at the end of the day, these different situations, these catastrophes bring you and I together. It's no miracle that after September 11, the number of Muslims which came towards the religion skyrocketed. Because people, their eyes are now being opened that what's this religion really about? And the minute catastrophe takes place in our lives, you and I become united. Here's an example. Imagine you've got different individuals sitting in a plane, in a train. And one individual is African American, one person is white, one person, for example, is black, one person is Mexican, one person is this, is that. And they're looking at each other and they have certain biases within their hearts. The white man must be looking at the black man. These are the negative stereotypes which we have in saying, you know, I better keep my money safe. The black man is looking at the white man and saying, man, this guy probably very rich. You know, these stereotypes that we have. The Mexican is looking at somebody else and saying something. We have negative stereotypes. And there's a lot of shock between our communities with these negative stereotypes. Now imagine for a split second that the same train goes into a catastrophe and it hits a wall. You'll find that the split second that these individuals are trying to escape, everyone becomes heart on heart, and all of a sudden all of the stereotypes are out of the window. Now the person who is white is holding the hand of the person who's black and is helping him out of the train. The Arab is looking at the Mexican man and helping him. No longer are there any more stereotypes because now we're in mode catastrophe. And this is what happened to our world. When a catastrophe like September 11 happens, even within a building where thousands have died, 300 of them are Muslim. It's not that simply were non-Muslims who died. No, even Muslims died. Such catastrophes bring us together. And the more the media tries to denounce our presence, the more the media tries to destroy us, Allah is raising. Allah is saying, the more you destroy, the more you lower, the more you bring down, the more I raise. And it's interesting that within the Quran, when we examine the story of Yusuf, Yusuf at one point, brothers and sisters, and I think about this, the strength and the significance, at one point in his life is taken by 9 of his brothers. And he is in the depth of a well, in the middle of a well. Imagine, you're a prophet of God, you feel secure that you have 9 brothers, and your brothers take you and drop you in a well. After being in a well, look at the planning of Allah. Allah says, no matter how low you are, I will at one point raise you. That the his life, he is in a well. The end of his life, he is holding the keys to the treasury of the strongest state in the world. Allah is saying, you can be as low as possible, and I can raise you to the highest degrees. As low as somebody might bring you. As much as somebody might lower your status, as much as somebody might bash you, as much as you're a sister trying to keep your hijab and there's a constant attack of the media at you, as much as you're trying to reject the materialistic aspects which come towards your life, when you try to abstain from bad things, when you try to lower your gaze, people will mock you, people will fool you. Allah says, don't worry, I will raise you. The same way I raised Yusuf from the well and I made him a king, I will raise you. The same way I raised Imam Hussein after being killed from 30,000 against 72, and today his companions multiplied to millions, I will raise you. Don't worry. To me, that message resonates. And anytime I'm standing alone, I tell you, specifically in high school, when I was in high school, some of the worst situations happening, and I'm thinking to myself, oh Allah, I'm alone. Because the minute I was at home, I had this 3D image picture in my mind that everything is great. My parents have taught me salah, siyam, everything is fine. I had a 3D image of Islam. It was so crystal clear, as if I was in a safe zone. The minute you go to high school, you have another 3D picture in your mind. Now the picture is so different. There's two completely different pictures. And I'm thinking to myself, oh Allah, what do I do now? I've got two completely conflicting pictures which I have to reconcile with. I'm going home, my parents are telling me to pray, and I go to school, my friends are looking at me like, what are you doing? Why are you standing up and down? Why do you look so weird? What is this you're wearing on your head? And I have to reconcile with these things in my life. Honest to God, as a youth in high school, one of the biggest problems which I went through is I'm standing alone. Oh Allah, help me. What do? What's my movement? If I'm standing alone and the whole world is against me, what's my position now? And Allah keeps pointing to it. If you stand alone, I will raise you. Musa stood alone with a stick against Fir'aun. Allah raised him and made him the king. Look at this. Allah takes Yusuf from the pits of a well. He puts him and he makes him a king. Allah takes Imam Hussein alayhi salam and he makes him more alive than any of us. Allah saying there's a message. As much as someone will try to denounce you, in the back of your mind you know that I am there to raise you. And there's a constant salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And I always tell my young brothers and sisters, do not be scared. Never be scared. Because Allah will raise you. If somebody is trying to denounce you, you will be raised. Best example, classical examples. When I see Imam Hussein alayhi salam, a man with so much conviction, so much movement, that his brother warns him. He says to him, Hussein, you're going, there are armies out there. And they are serious about killing you. Even when the man comes to Imam Hussein and he says, Hussein, he would like to have a meeting with you. Imam Hussein sits with two men. One man looks at the other and says, let's kill him now, when he takes out the sword. And he says, Hussein, if you walk out of this door, we will kill you. Death was so real. And Imam looks at him, he says, which one of you is going to kill me? And why are you going to kill me? And Imam just walks out. To me, that's a strong move. That I am walking out even though the sword is in your hand. Even though you're there, death is right there, it's so close, I'm going to walk out. And I'm going to walk towards Karbala. And my 72 will be against your 30,000. To me, that's a stance of power. If we all stood that stance of power, brothers and sisters, believe me. If we stood together, united each other, and stood the stance of power, the biggest superpowers today will not be able to affect us. The materialistic warlords who are sitting with their suits and their cigars, who have their legs up on their desks, who are injecting our societies with the music, with drugs, with alcohol, and are constantly reeling us in, if you and I unite together, they'll never be able to infiltrate. Because it's simply a materialistic game. You and I might see it and we fall for it, but at the end of the day, there are people who not only market to our physiques, but also market to our psychologies. And they're very smart at doing it, because they know best example in society is music. As much as we say music might entertain us, music might relax us, brothers and sisters, music is one of the biggest distractions that mankind has ever known. It doesn't relax you, it distracts you. And I was always interested in this. I remember at school I would sit And my certain students would sit next to me and say, look, we're listening to this music. Where are your headphones? And I said, I don't have headphones. I don't listen to these things. They say, no, we're so relaxed. We can do our math homework, science homework. We're really relaxed. And I didn't get it. But the more research you do about it, the more you realize that this doesn't relax an individual. It distracts them. Best proof is take a person who's listening to music and turn off their music. They immediately rage. They get so upset, they demand you to put the music back on. And if this person was really relaxed, then he shouldn't care. There should be no problem with removing the music. They should be able to keep it down, and they shouldn't want it to continue playing. Example, for example, in today's society, any club, the three main components are people, music, and alcohol. Imagine you walk inside, these people are jumping up and down, you turn off the music. What's the immediate reaction? Everything is just so still. And I tested this when I was a teenager. I would have some sort of music playing in my car. My windows would be up. I'd be in my own world, in my own society, my own universe. The minute I brought my windows down, my parents are calling me, my brother's calling me, my sister. I've got so many things to do. Society, I hear people cursing, people speaking about their problems. I say, you know what, that world I was just in, the minute I lowered the windows, this world is gone. It hit me, man, you are so distracted. You are so distracted in these 5 minutes. Open your eyes, see the world. And sometimes we see, it's interesting in our societies, there are those who put the music so high. They raise it such a high level. And I bet you this individual never listened to this music like this when he was a kid. When he was a child, he never listened to it that high. He started very, very slowly. And the parents got divorced. Alcohol got into the picture. Drugs were there. Violence were there. The sexual misconducts were there. And life kept on getting more painful and more painful and more painful. As life got more and more painful, the music increased and increased and increased. The higher it goes, the more you forget. The louder it is, the more I forget. And I'm just trying to forget. Help me forget. Let me forget everything I've done in my life. Let me forget my existence. Let me mold into this world and forget that I even have some sort of responsibility. This is one of the main purposes of the materialistic warlords out there. The Imam's movement, when he came exactly against these things. He says, mankind, you have 10 or 5 people who are controlling the wealth of the masses. Today we have in the United States, 99% of the wealth is controlled by 1% of the population. That's a problem. Within the life of the Imam, the same thing was existent. 10 people had thousands and thousands of dirhams of gold. Imam says, most of you are controlling the wealth, and I've got people who don't even have food. He goes out towards them. When we look at the Imam's movement, it's completely against the materialistic movement. And even when the Imam is out there, they say to him, Hussein, give us your hand. Do bay'ah. Yazid promises him, he says, I'll give you the wealth. I'll give you the woman, anything you want. Imam says, a person like me will never do bay'ah to a person like you. Why? Imam says, I'd rather die free than become a slave of the materialistic world that's there today. And even though he's out there on the battlefield, even though the Imam is confronted with thousands, he doesn't care. The most beautiful thing is that he sacrifices everyone around him, even himself, even his brother, even his family. That later Lady Zainab, when she stands against Yazid, and he looks at her, he says to her, what do you think of what Allah has done to your Hussein? Look at the reply. She says, I have only seen beautiful and sweet. Your brother is killed, he's on the battlefield. Your sons have been killed, your brother is killed. What's this beauty and sweetness? She says, as long as we are free, and we are not materialistic slaves to this man who was in front of me who was a tyrant, we're in sweets and beauty. And even he goes to Lady Zainab, he says to her, do you think this is positive what Allah has done? What do you think of Allah killing Hussein? Look at this, the theological destruction, God killing individuals. She says, Allah never killed them. These were men who walked towards their fate. Interestingly, Yazid's wife was a lady by the name of Hind. And Hind was of Jewish descent. She was one of the servants of Lady Fatima alayhi salam in the household of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. And when Lady Zainab sees Hind, she recognizes that this was the same lady who at a young age used to serve us in our household, who was with us. I recognize her. Hind never recognized Zainab. So she comes to Lady Zainab, she says to her, sister, which land are you from? Lady Zainab says to her, we are from the land of Medina. And now is impressed. She says, Medina, I know a family which is from there. I have Amir al-Mu'mineen's family. I know Hussein, I know Abbas, I know Fatima, I know Zainab, I know this holy household, I know them. She looks at Lady Zainab, she says to her, tell me, how is my master Abbas? Lady Zainab looks at him and she says to her, oh him, if you ask me about Abbas, then his head is on that spear. And if you ask me about his two hands, we have left them. She looks at Lady Zainab, she says to her sister, tell me where is my master Hussein? She says to her, oh sister, Hussein's head is also on the spear and his body is in Karbala. She says to her, there is one more lady I have to ask you about. Tell me, where is Zainab? Lady Zainab says to her, oh hen, don't you recognize me? I am Zainab. She says to her, oh hen, can you not recognize me? I am Zainab. Karbala has changed me to this extent. When Lady Zainab alayhi salam returns towards Medina, she knocks on the door of her husband Abdullah. Abdullah opens the door and he looks at Zainab and says to her, who are you? Zainab says to him, Abdullah, do you not recognize me? I am Zainab, your wife.
Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sa'alamu alladhina zalamu ala Muhammadin. Ayyamun qalban yanqalibun wal 'aqibatu lil muttaqin ya Allah.
Let's raise our hands towards dua, please. It's a blessed night. We have many who are asking us for our dua. I'd like to thank the dear brothers and organizers at Idara-e-Jaferia for having me for the 3 nights. It's been my pleasure and my honor to be amongst you. May Allah keep us strong. May Allah keep us united. May Allah bless you for your hard work. So thank you.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Amman yujib المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء.
Together.
أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. يا الله 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 يا الله. اللهم شافي جميع المرضى يا الله. اللهم اقض جميع حوائجنا يا الله. Heal all of our sick ones يا الله. Keep us on the path of Muhammad wa ali Muhammad يا الله. Do not put upon us leaders who are not merciful with us يا الله. Our dear brothers and sisters who are oppressed all over the world, keep the safety in their lands يا الله. ولأرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات نقرأ سورة المباركة الفاتحة تسبقها صلوات.